well, what you think about China and Africa and the relationship that's kind of happening there with development.
Great question. The short answer would be I don't know enough details to give you. I have suspicions, but I don't know enough details in Africa to give you an informed response. I've been in Jamaica a lot this year, so I can talk to you a bit more about Jamaica, because you can imagine I asked every Jamaican I could speak to what they thought about China's role in Jamaica. And what I could glean was, whatever we think of the Chinese, they are building infrastructure in Jamaica that Britain chose not to build in 300 years. This is just a simple fact of it. They've just cut the travel time to Montego Bay in half, which obviously what that does for the Jamaican economy and Jamaican business. Is there a worry? Should there be suspicion? Yes, of course. It's a major international power. Jamaica's a small island. However, what was interesting talking to most of the Jamaicans I spoke to, in fact, all of them, even the ones that had a problem with the Chinese relationship there, when I said, what is it the Chinese are doing that American capital or British capital or French capital is not doing? What are the specific negative things that the Chinese are doing? And no one could name anything. So their gripes with the Chinese were gripes with capitalism, not gripes with the Chinese. The problem is, and those of you who are Caribbean will know this, there is a sort of slight anti-Chinese bigotry in the Caribbean, because they're the successful people it's okay to hate. You can't really hate white people, they have too much power in the Caribbean, and we've sort of learned that if when white people die, there's big consequences. So Jamaicans in Jamaica, they sort of still admire Europeans despite that history. And there is this suspicion of the Chinese, and that's not to say that there is not valid reasons to be concerned. I'm just saying the suspicion is a suspicion rooted in their Chineseness, not rooted in the actual behaviors. One other example I'll give you. There are several projects that the Chinese have proposed in Jamaica that the Jamaican people said no to, the Jamaican government had to say no to. The Jamaican government then said no to the Chinese. What was the Chinese response? Was it to send the CIA in? Was it to overthrow the Jamaican democracy? Was it to cut off aid to Jamaica? No. They said, okay, we proposed a business deal. You said no. Here's another one. So what I would put to people, and I can't say that this is the case in Africa, because the power dynamics may be completely different. In the case of Jamaica, if the Jamaican government does not negotiate in the best interest of the Jamaican people, whose fault is that? The Chinese government is negotiating in the best interest of its people. The reason why I say that, because if we've told them no for three or four things already, and they haven't murdered us or bombed us or overthrown, then clearly we can keep telling them no if we don't like something. My fear, genuine fear, is that some of the crooked politicians in Jamaica will embezzle some of the money coming from China and then say, hey, look, the evil Chinese did it. I genuinely fear that as a possibility also. So I think we have to be, this is a situation that we have to manage very, very carefully, because there is an opportunity for the Caribbean, at least, to parlay a relationship with China slightly to its best interest. That does not mean China is on a charity project. That does not mean China does not have human rights abuses at home. That does not mean that China is there because they love Jamaican people. They're there to make money and do business. The question is, can Jamaica or other countries parlay their relationship with China to their benefit? If the question is no, then they should sever relationships with the Chinese. If the question is yes, the question is how do they do that? But I think we have to be very, very careful that the sort of yellow peril sort of vibe and the assumption that they will behave exactly the same as other major powers have behaved, it's not proven yet. And I'm not saying that I'm naive that they might also do that, but I don't think it's intelligent to approach that relationship as I see a lot of people doing, with the assumption that it will be identical to relationships with other major powers in the region. Happy to be proved wrong, happy to learn more, but that was my assessment from talking to a last example I'll give you on this. I know I keep saying that. When you go and see them building the roads in Jamaica, you see Chinese workers and black workers working next to each other in Jamaica. It's the first time in the history of the Caribbean anyone who wasn't black or Indian did manual labor. It's the truth. So it's a different attitude. You see the bosses are, there's a Jamaican boss, there's a Chinese boss. You see the workers, there's a Chinese worker and there's Jamaican workers. Doesn't mean it's perfect. It's in no means perfect, but no country develops perfectly. So I think I have a bit more of a nuanced view of the Chinese, probably just because I'm biased as well. Part of it, the relationship, Jamaica's particular relationship with Britain and America has been so negative that I just don't want to allow that baggage to allow me to approach a new country that way. But Jamaicans in Jamaica may see it quite differently. There's people on both sides. Lots of people are like, I'm making loads of money out of the Chinese, so it's wonderful. Lots of people are like Bounty Killer criticized them recently, they're taking over the country, all this kind of stuff. But foreigners own most of Jamaica anyway. So when we say the Chinese are taking over, who are they taking over from? They're not taking over from Jamaicans, because Jamaicans don't own the country. So there were already foreigners owning. So what we're really complaining about is Chinese capital replacing American, Canadian, or British capital. But we never said the Americans were taking over, even though we pay 140% of our GDP to the IMF in some years. Anyway,